look at this stadium that you see right now, none of this was here. We had no lights, no press box, no scoreboard, none of this grass out here. This was all, there were some tumbleweeds out there in the back, but we had no, the bleachers weren't even the same. We had little wooden bleachers behind the track. We played no home games for the first 10 years here, and we didn't have any other grass to practice on. We had five teams, and they all practiced sideways here. I was the baseball coach, and I had no baseball field. I didn't play one game that year at home. All the games, I practiced on the dirt or in the asphalt, and that's pretty much the way it was that first year. We had a wooden scoreboard down there. We had one home game in the afternoon, and that was it. But this was vastly different. There was no weight room. I actually helped the kids plant these bushes here. They were little tiny things, and now they're pretty big all around here. But we didn't have any of these snack bars, restroom facilities, fields over here, none of this. On campus, biggest change, there was no security on campus. There was no policeman on campus. There was no gates or any of that there, you know, and it was just kids were kids. The biggest thing, like I'd say probably would be from those days would be maybe dress code. Back then, the girls could not wear Levi's, or everyone had to wear a dress, okay? And the boys had to wear shirts, and they had to have a collar on them, and they had to be tucked in. And that was one of the biggest bugaboos is, and it had to be a certain length of skirts. So the girls were always on their knees in the counselor's office measuring the skirts to be sure they were long enough. And the boys were all having their shirts tucked in. They had to have their hair cut a certain length. And the other thing was, in the faculty, among the teachers, you could not be seen on campus unless you're in a coat or tie. You had to have a coat and tie at all times. And when I coached there, I changed five times a day because we had to go to the staff room, to the mailbox. But anytime, even after you finished coaching, to go home, you had to be in a coat and a tie. No mustaches, no sideburns, none of these things like this. And all the women on the faculty, of course, wore dresses. And it was just a different time, different era back then. But, I was just trying to think of the other things that we had there. We had, of course, we had no electronics on campus. And can you believe that? Hard to go all day long without a cell phone or anything else. We didn't have that. And we didn't even have transistor radios or anything like that on campus back then. Good times we had here. Sometimes I remember some of the best things we ever did. I used to play Santa Claus, and I would do for the little kids in the school over there. I loved that, those little kids, and they used to wear T-shirts, almost a Trojan, and then we'd have the faculty would pull a chariot around. They put reindeer horns on helmets, and they would dress up like reindeer, and they'd pull me in on Santa Claus, and I'd come in on a fire engine down here, and they'd park it down by that school down there, and those little kids would come out and see Santa Claus on the fire engine, they'd go crazy. They couldn't stop them. The kids would run out of school, and that was a lot of fun. And then we had a lot of it were the good rallies where we had the village people and this and that. And then I remember we had a rally where I sang with Buck Owens, had me up on the stage. You know, that was really big. We had quite a few of those. Yeah, they came back. And they came back and coached. And not only that, my first year I coached in 1965, I had on my team Dr. Baker, who came back, and he's our team doctor. I even coached his kids, okay? Then we had Dr. Alexander, who's our team dentist. He came back and was ours. Then we had Dr. Thompson, who came back and was our school principal, my last principal at Foothill High School. So I always think about guys like that, the chief of police, this and that. And I often wondered, you know, Dr. Thompson used to always, in 1965, they used to always say, I remember he used to always, I always told him, if I knew then what I know now, you'd have played a lot more. And I did that a lot of times. And then one day, Dr. Thompson, after he was principal, and after I'd done that several times, he got the microphone one day and said, you know something, if I'd have known then what I know now, you're right, I'd have played a lot more. I'd have played as much as I wanted, any position I wanted. So, you know, that's kind of nice. Whenever you have a principal, after you've taught 40 years and your last principal, somebody that you've coached, you know you've been around too long, or at least I mean, and when these doctors did surgery on me, you know, I hope they didn't have a flashback but to double sessions and have some bad things, or my dentist yanked out the wrong tooth. You know, that's you hope you have a good bunch of guys there. Was once upon a time they asked me, because I coached Buck Owens' son. He played here, okay. And they always say, why don't you get Buck Owens to come out and play? I'm not going to go call Buck Owens to come and play. You know what he is? Back then he was on Hee Haw, which was one of the most popular TV shows of all. He was singing in London with the Beatles, okay? He was popular, and they want me to get him to come out the foothill and play. Yeah, just drop everything. I said, I can't do that. And I said, he's got too many things to do. So one day we're having a rally, and I'm with Steve Sabalka and Ted Oliver, and I have a red, white, and blue guitar, and we get up on the stage, and we start singing. Oh, it was a song called Oh My Heart Skips a Beat. I could sing it for you if you want. But anyway, we were singing this song, and the people are going crazy. And I'm thinking, if this all it takes to be a rock star, I'm on the road, because I'm big time, you know. But you know what they're cheering for? Behind us, somebody talked to Buck Owens, and they had him on a pedestal, and they put him up, coming up behind us, and he went up to the sky, to the top of the, and they had a light on him. We didn't know he was behind us. So I whirled around, and I saw him. Oh, my goodness. It's Buck Owens there, and that's who they're cheering for, not me. So you know what Buck Owens did? After it's all over, he said, you know, I've been wanting to meet you all my life, Coach Preminter. He said, now, you know, I'd like to have you sing a little song with me. So he calls me up on the stage, okay? Me and Buck Owens. This is, you know, like being on The Voice or something. And you know what song he was going to sing? Streets of Bakersfield. Okay, I don't know all the words. I just know the chorus, and I love it, you know, the rest of it. So here I am with Buck Owens up on the stage in front of all these people, ad-libbing, and I don't know jack nothing. And so I blew my big chance and going. And if you ever go to the Crystal Palace, go to the Crystal Palace, go in the door, take a right-hand turn, go down to the end. There's a letter I wrote to Buck Owens that he posted in the window down there. I said, I apologize for not more. You know, if you don't know the streets of Bakersfield, that's not about like not knowing the Pledge of Allegiance, you know. So I just jacked up.